something about saying education and
If you really look at it, the common theme seems to be that education needs to be experiential. Someone needs to experience fun, one needs to experience it through, whether Nag spoke about stories, whether Manish spoke about humor, all of this essentially means that education cannot continue to be delivered as monologues in classrooms, as we've all seen. Right? That becomes critical. So let me touch on something that is slightly connected, but not necessarily the same as what everyone else spoke about. Assessments as a driver for changing learning and teaching is something that I want to speak about. This is a slide that I've unabashedly flicked from Madan. He has used it in some conference in the past, but this is obviously, it's very, if you look at this slide, there are obviously two critical pieces of data there. It says that India, the median age of the Indian population is probably was probably the lowest in 2009. Right at 25. And if you look at the supply-demand situation of workers, when I say workers, obviously knowledge workers included, India obviously seems to be extremely well-poised, at least from a numbers perspective, of where we can be in about 10 years' time. So whenever we have shown this slide to anyone, I mean, especially who are new to India, they've all said, wow, this seems to be a very interesting situation. And if you look at even China, it's got a minus 10% growth or shortfall in the number of people that they will have to do the kind of jobs that they need to do. But is this really going to be a dividend for us in the future? At least the present says that there is a big if there. And what is the big if? The big if is that while we have a huge number of people in the right age, they also are largely unemployable. Recent surveys have pegged this number. As Dave said, things in India seem to be pegged at different numbers at different points of time. 70% of India's youth seem to have some degree of unemployability. When I say unemployability, it's not that they don't have the knowledge, but they might not have the kind of skills that are needed for the kind for the jobs that they're trying to apply for. Correlation with academic performance is low. All of us know that. I think each of us will have at least one experience of the batch topper not necessarily getting the first job that, when you went to either engineering campus or to a B school campus. Abysmally low demonstration of application of knowledge. This is exactly where Indians are faltering today. We don't seem to know how to apply the knowledge. We seem to have good knowledge. We seem to imbibe whatever is prescribed in the textbook. I think people, at least from India, would allude to some parts of the movie Three Idiots, right? Where someone is asked to describe the machine, and someone who actually describes it in the way it's exactly written in the textbook actually gets the whole, gets the credit, and someone who just says that it's something that just help humans, he's actually told, hey, are you kidding me? Are you trying to tell me that this is the definition of a machine? That's exactly what's happening in Indian schools today. All of us have been exposed to learning environments where it's a monologue from the teacher. We just are asked to replicate what's written in a textbook, and at the end of it, what comes out is a set of people that are unemployable but knowledgeable. Exam and measurement systems cling to legacy methods. The British did leave us behind with a very good legacy, which is English, but they also left behind a very bad legacy, which is the methodology of teaching. Right? If you go back a few centuries in the past, or maybe even more, we hear stories, especially maybe grandmas telling us, etc., where learning itself in a Gurukul, for example, depends on a guru teaching his pupils, taking them out into the field, showing some experiential ways of learning, and so on and so forth. We seem to have forgotten all of that. We are tuned to rewarding rote learning. Right? You go to any school, rote learning, and I'll show you some examples of how we have allowed assessment systems to drive this behavior in schools, students, and teachers. And it significantly impacts learning and teaching methods. Students are measured on memory of learning or knowledge as against learning outcomes. Now, what is learning outcomes? Supposedly, learning outcomes are defined and designed for every part of the curriculum. Unfortunately, I think the definition of those learning outcomes are wrong. What we're talking about are not learning outcomes per se, is behavior that someone is expected to exhibit after undergoing training, studying, or whatever it is. But we seem to approximate learning outcomes to does the person know? It is not extending to can the person apply what he knows, right? And that's where the biggest gap is. So are today's students really ready for the real world? How are we giving you all these insights? Just quick slide. I won't dwell too much on this. We have been pre-recruitment exams for India's knowledge workers for the last 10 to 12 years, and obviously we have a rich pile of data that we have based on which we believe that the numbers that are coming out of saying that 70% unemployable, 80% unemployable is completely true. The reason is we obviously have all the expertise to say that. I'll just give you a few examples today of what I was alluding to a little earlier. This is a sample question from a classic social science. Name the animals that the people of Harappan civilization worshipped. Right? How does this help the student? Does it help the student in any way if he answers this way? Could this question have been, how do we know that the people of Harappan civilization worshipped animals? I'll again allude to something that Dave spoke a little earlier. He said he asked his son Oliver, how many legs does the dinosaur have? And he said 2 or 4 or whatever the number is. If that question was instead that, what do you think will be the impact if the dinosaur had 3 legs, right? The candidate will actually have to experience or think about what will happen if someone were to have 3 legs, right? Will you have balance? Will you have topple over? And therefore, the entire concept of 2 legs and having a balance and all of that gets imbibed in the student. That's how you will inculcate the entire culture of inquiring and learning. Give another example, I'll move a little ahead. Class 10th, science. List 6 differences between real and virtual images. Most questions in class 10, class 12 is list, how many, define. These are words that have really killed all possible amounts of creativity in Indians. Couldn't this easily have been this kind of a question? Couldn't you have encouraged the student to think a little more? How many ways can you think of to figure out how if an image formed between a refractive lens is real or virtual? Or why does a real image produced after refraction from a lens have different features than a virtual image produced by the same lens? This at least encourages the kid to think a little more. And surprise, you go to higher education, and I'm talking of first semester B mechanical engineering paper, look at the questions. What are the different types of gear train? Define them. Right? And you get 6 marks for this question. 35 is the pass mark for any subject in engineering. 5 or 6 of such questions completely learned by rote learning, and the person could end up becoming an engineer. And these are because we are teachers and students are learned to meet the end objective provided. What is the end objective? If the end objective is answering questions like what you have in the top, the teacher is going to teach that way, the student is going to learn that way. But if these are the kind of questions, the teacher will have no option but to ensure that his students actually are attuned to thinking about this in a more positive way. Asking questions, inquiring, trying to construct, trying to imagine, because that's what we seem to have lost. And that is the core of what I'm trying to say today, is that there is significant scope for us to use changing the kind of methodology that we use for assessments, changing the assessment itself to drive learning and education. Is this change possible at all? The answer is yes, and it comes from not from the high-end institutions of India, but it comes from the CBSE system itself. The CBSE 2010 manual actually talks about all this. CBSE, as most of you would have known, in the year 2009, actually, came out with a system called the CCE, Continuous and Comprehensive Evaluation. It did away with the board exams in class 10. It also ensured that there is a series of formative and summative assessments that a student has to go through. There are scholastic, non-scholastic behavioral aspects that needs to get captured in defining how a student has performed in a particular class. And this is actually, in a very small way, in a small but not definitely not an insignificant way, driving change in schools. There is still a long way to go. Schools are still struggling in terms of how this can be implemented, but this is definitely a step in the right direction. Focus has definitely shifted to developing a deep learning environment instead of comprehensive learning content. So change is definitely happening. Assessment in today's perspective, what's changing? Focus on remembering to focus on application. Everyone's been crying horse over the last many years saying that application is what's missing in Indian students. Everyone knows, seems to have knowledge. They score 85%, 90%, 95%. Manish spoke about even 100% being scored so frequently. But the problem is that knowledge converting into behavioral changes where you are applying the knowledge into stuff that you can solve on a day-to-day basis? How is it we're getting done today? We are using simulations in games, and I'll dwell a little bit on simulations in games on the next slide. Focus on evaluation was the earlier thing. As I said, board exam, 95% is the target that you have in life. It's moving to focus on remedy and improvement. There is formative assessments that are being done, rich reports that are being expected from these assessments, and then prescribed interventions from teachers, etc., to ensure that the student actually improves through diagnostic assessments. Focus on learning content prescribed in syllabus. So you have class chapter 1 to chapter 18, nothing else. Focus on learning outcomes, right? Can you define learning outcome for class 5 saying, should, for example, in English language, should be able to have a conversation, free-willing conversation for 5 minutes, could be a simple learning outcome defined for a class 3 student in English language. If we start defining it that way, and if we start defining our assessments in line with that, this will definitely happen. Affects the perception of education, and I mean, this is just English, right? So the shift is definitely happening. Again, some examples of incremental changes. I've just picked something up. So can we have questions, multiple choice questions that are better distractors, ensures that people actually think between the distractors. Answers are not very, very obvious. It doesn't come out of rote learning. It's not picked up from a textbook. The big shift, so what I was speaking about so far is the incremental shift that easily can happen. It can happen on scale. The big shift, though, is in using personalized learning environments, simulations, ensuring that you have experiential learning, people are able to experience what the kind of knowledge is that they're getting, etc. The world of simulations provides a simulator environment for assessments. Test takers are subjected to real life situations. We conducted a small experiment of our own, and it's quite successful. We have created a simulation-based assessment solution for testing management skills in B-school grads. Now, we've always seen B-school grads being the creme de la creme, really. People are vying to kind of hire them. And even in cases where it's not from the top 20 B-schools, you typically have students going through a GD process or a personal interview or a multiple choice question assessment. What we have created is a simulated assessment, simulated environment for a student to exhibit what he has learned in management school and display them. At the end of a 1 hour assessment, it's a game that they play. You get a score on various parameters of that concern management education, things like leadership, things like financial planning, and so on and so forth. And this, we've seen, provides a rich variety of data for recruiters to make far better decisions. In summary, change in learning and teaching methodology is the only way that India can redeem its pledge and fulfill its expectations. Obviously, there's a need for some baggage and legacy systems to be shed. New measurement systems are crucial. Some look back to the glory days in the Indian history. As I said, we briefly alluded to, and Nag also spoke about, the early methods of learning that we've had. Adopting some of those methods of learning is probably what the answer is to today's problems. Adopting technology as key driver of change in education and examinations. Hybrid, interactive, immersive. So it obviously can't be just immersive. It just can't be simulation alone. It's going to be a mix of both, right? Can we have the right balance and ensure that we have the right kind of inputs that goes to our students so that they become better and employable students of, I mean, people, citizens of tomorrow? Look at international best practices, customize it for India, and start using them. So this, in summary, is what I had to kind of quickly share with all of you. And at a later point of time, we can probably take some questions. Right. Thank you.